Good morning, Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Gurmeet Singh, respected Dean School of Management Professor K. Chandrasekhar Rao, coordinators of this EDP Dr. Kasilingam and Dr. Madan Mohan, colleagues in the department, participants of this EDP program, good morning all. Our DMS, being the first academic unit of the Pondicherry University, has its unique position in the market. DMS has always been responding to the demands of the industry in terms of updating curriculum and introducing new programs and courses. And in response to the demand from the industry, DMS introduced 2-year full-time program on MBA data analytics and part-time 3-year part-time MBA program in 2018-19 last year. I also recall our department faculty's contribution in the past by being part of very high level training programs such as management development programs, executive development programs for government and business organizations, many times as resource persons and few times as organizers. And I can personally remember the very high level program on performance budgeting, which was offered to directors of IT of southern states in India, and one program on project management for undersecretary level for the Department of Planning and Development. We were also resource persons for various government of Puducherry departments like Industries Department, Local Administration Department, and other police training school. We have been continuously offering programs for these departments. So we have already the necessary inputs to be given to all these organizations. And in the recent past, we have also started offering FDPs on research methodology and analytical skills development. We are also planning to offer more EDPs and MDPs for various organizations like government organizations, NGOs, family-owned business organizations, etc., besides big business organizations. Each faculty has charted out programs on their areas of expertise, and shortly we will be releasing the training calendar of this year. Some of the programs which are ready to offer include professional selling skills, finance for non-finance managers, integrated reporting for CFOs, machine learning applications in finance, international financial reporting standards, cross-cultural HR management, etc. When I took over as departmental head, I decided my focus area as training and consultancy, and DMS has a clear focus on 3 levels of programs, namely faculty development program, then executive development program for middle level executives, and MDPs for top management personnel. Further, as per our dean's suggestion, we also plan to conduct EDPs for alumni as continuous education to update themselves. Coming to this program, analytics, widely recognized for its problem solving and predictive prowess, has become an essential navigational tool. Analytics is more important than even during these unprecedented times. Today, we find many business and analytical leaders rallying around new analytical solutions or redesigning existing ones to support 4 critical business priorities arising from the pandemic, such as protecting and supporting employees, informing strategic and financial decisions, managing supply chain safety, risk and cost, and engaging customers in new and increasingly digital ways. All of this is the bread and butter of analytics. As organizations plan for the new normal, they will also examine current workforce production and service strategies and how to come out of COVID-19 stronger and more agile. As a society, we have seen how important even the basic line graphs, bar charts, and heat maps are to understanding the spread of the virus. We have heard a lot about various models in terms of predicting deaths associated with COVID-19. Many people want to see the data and understand the facts in this rapidly changing environment. The public has even heard about how artificial intelligence is being used to help sort patients and develop vaccines. As awful as this pandemic is, and it is terrible, it has driven home the need for data and analysis. This 5-day EDP is a follow-up of FDPs on research methodology and analytical skills development, in which our department has its core strength. This EDP is entirely hands-on approach to data science, where participants would be working with data sets to generate insights for business and research. Further, this EDP on analytics will have more series which the coordinators will explain. With this small note, I have great pleasure in welcoming our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Gurmeet Singh. Thank you, sir. And as a leader, he always motivates us to reach newer heights. I want to place on record the seamless facilitation his office provided to get his appointment. And thank you, sir, for being here to preside over this EDP. And your mere presence will motivate and cheer us. We welcome you, Professor. And I welcome our Dean, Professor Rao, for encouraging and motivating us by giving lots of ideas for future EDPs and MDPs. We welcome you, Professor, for being here to deliver inaugural address. I welcome Dr. Kausalingam and Dr. Madan Mohan, the coordinators of this EDP, who have taken all out efforts to offer this program. I also welcome my resourceful colleagues who have a lot of ideas to offer future programs. Most importantly, I take this opportunity to welcome all the participants for this EDP for sparing your valuable time to equip yourselves during this pandemic in a right manner. You have made a wise decision, and we promise you that this EDP will definitely deliver what you look for. We very welcome every one of you, and we hope you will have enlightening sessions on all these 5 days and become an expert professional. Thank you for the opportunity. Or I welcome Dr. Kausalingam to give a note about this program.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, most respected Dean, respected Head of the Department, distinguished colleagues, and my dear participants, good morning to one and all present here. Let me join with my Head of the Department to welcome you all for this 5 days EDP. So why, as a coordinator, I have to tell why we are organizing this program. So way back 2011, when I joined in this department, so first I prepared a proposal and given to that time Head of the Department, Raya sir. He has asked me whether I have to, whether this one requires my signature. Yes, I said yes, sir. Then after signing, that is his style of dealing with me. After signing that proposal, he has gone through and he has asked me, he said, probably the fees is little less. Then I have told, see, this is a central funded institution. Being a central funded institution, we have a responsibility and we have a duty to give training and cater to the needs of the people without considering the cost, without considering the amount we generate. So that is the idea. Then I have further told him, so now I am this department, I am getting a salary from the government. So now this government is a welfare state. What is welfare state? So they collect money from the taxing the money from the people who are having the money, and they are supposed to spend it to the rural people. Now, instead of spending to the rural people or poor people, they are giving that money in the form of salary to the people, salary to the faculty members and other people. So, which means instead of giving directly, they are giving through us. So, which means we have a response. They believe that if it goes through us, it will reach more number of people. I feel the God has given certain knowledge to me. That is the trust. So now, as a trustee, what I have to do is, so I have to generate and I have to give more benefits to the people. So with the limited knowledge, so I have to generate, I have to give more. That is called principle of trusteeship. Still, I believe that principle of trusteeship given by Gandhiji. Now, why this program? I'm going to the many places to conduct BYOC examination. There I could see the way in which they have presented the BYOC and other things. So I feel we have to give the proper feedback to the people so that they will do good research. So 1 week before, that was the old one. Now 1 week before, one of the scholars has presented the thesis in the YWAS online examination. She was telling, so I have conducted a control group, I have conducted from experimental group, so two different group, but she was telling, I have conducted priority test. So how, when it is conducted for two different people, So how predictive test is possible? Then I realized still this program is having the necessity. So that is why I feel it has to be conducted. Now, see, presently, a few days you might be knowing. So that trend prevailing in Kalvan. So Kalvan, the Veli. So the China is terrorizing us, sitting in Kalvan and sitting along with Nepal and one side Rajasthan. So now, why they are doing? So we cannot live as it is. So we have a duty to respond to this situation. Now I feel I am very much worried what happened in Sri Lanka. Around 40,000 people, Tamils killed. That I feel that is because of the China. So now China, they have entered into the Anuradhapuram port. So because of that, it has forced Indian government to support the Sri Lanka. Because of that, we have lost 40,000 people. So now, so we to respond to this, all the people, all the young people, they have responded that we have to boycott the Chinese schools. But when OnePlus has introduced that new version of the model, within 10 minutes, all booking over. So people, they want to, they restrict their buying, but they are not able to do because the facilities offered by the China. So they are giving more number of facilities. That is why they are going for it. Now, many people in America, they want to restrict the China. But if you look at the American journals, so they, most of the articles nowadays, it is from China. Now, in fact, some of the Chinese, some of the American journals, they have appointed a specialist people to translate the American Mandarin, American literature, American articles, the Chinese article available in Mandarin to translate in English. So, which means it has forced us. So now I feel, being a higher education institution, we have a responsibility. When China, they could provide 4 lakh patent. Our patent is 12,000. That was granted. Imagine 4 lakh, that is 12,000. So if you look at the patent, they are there. If you look at the market situation, so they are there. So now they are innovating new products. They are publishing new papers. They are raising the patents. So which means their higher education institution are playing a vital role. Every higher education institution, they have tie up with the industries and they are generating new products. Because of the new innovation, they are capturing the market. So now the government, we are introducing the Right to Info Education Act, they have catered to the primary education. Now for a higher education, it is the responsibility of every individual to concentrate on research more and more and publish good articles, innovate new products. Only by this way we can counter attack on China. So I feel we have to conduct more and more programs so that they will publish. That is why after seeing the news of Kalvan, so what has happened, I have put a mail to the head of the department. Madam, I am going to organize 10 programs like this. Every year I will conduct 4 programs, but not this year. I will not restrict to 4 programs. I will conduct 110 programs, more than 10 programs. So to educate, to give knowledge to the higher education people who are in the higher education and develop themselves, publish more and more, innovate new and new, then only we can capture the China. Now, you may not think it may not be possible. Now, our the NASM dean is there. Probably he might accept. So now, what happened to the financial market? We have a SEBI, the Manmohan Singh has introduced SEBI, Manmohan Singh has introduced NSE. Because of that, so though China has beaten us every field, but with respect to financial market, they are sending the people to India to find out what is the surveillance system adopted by NSE to control the financial market. So what we have done in the financial market, same thing we can do in the higher education institution so that we can publish more and more articles. So now I feel the success of these programs will be if every individual after attending this program, if they publish at least one good article, that will be the success of this program. So I hope everybody will gather knowledge, everybody gain knowledge. So So you can interact with me anytime, not only now, in future also, so that in joint we can publish more and more papers, so that we can provide a talk to the Chinese, not to the Prime Minister. Everybody can join with our Prime Minister to attack on the China. This is the only way possible here. So I feel this program is having need and necessity at this present juncture. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for the opportunity given. Thank you. Now, I request the Honorable Dean Sir to give inaugural address.
So we will invite the Vice Chancellor to inaugurate it. You have looked at from the point of research. I have an experience. My son has done data analytics course in Chennai. What they have been introducing to him, all the tools through the research papers published by faculty members. So indirectly, the teaching papers published by the research will be the basis for audio. Some problem with audio?
Sir, we are able to hear. Please continue, sir.
So, whether Vice Chancellor is online, we will ask him to inaugurate, then I will start the session. I can talk about.
After you speak, then he will deliver presidential address.
Now, I will just look at this program. It is not only useful for our research scholars, but also all those young freshers who are getting into the industry. Rather, I can tell you this is a type of an induction program. Instead of doing a course outside for the private organizations by paying 40,000, 50,000 rupees on basics of data analytics, this program provides all the basic required skills from a university in a coherent and structured syllabus, and with all hands-on experience, hands-on experiments. So tomorrow, this will be definitely be helpful to all of you while you take up your job. All those who are already in the jobs and those who are now presently and doing work at home and likely to go back to your jobs, this knowledge definitely helps you to take up the data analysis, data analytics in your organizations very quickly without wasting any more time. Because after the COVID, definitely the new normal will demand lots of skills from you. And this university is providing you, as a part of its university social responsibility, we have been proposing and planning to organize a series of this type of EDPs for the benefit of freshers, for the benefit of those young faculty and the executives who have just been working for the last 2-3 years, and those who are on work at home, and those who are likely to join back within 3-4 months, and for research scholars who are likely, the next destination for them is the consulting firms. So that is how this program has been designed. And incidentally, we will be interacting with all of you and telling about our university and the courses available for the benefit of you and your friends, your groups, and your maybe your own work groups, wherein you can share. With these few words, I invite our university leader, the leader of this university, who has been igniting all of us, especially when he is addressing on this NIRF review meeting, and then when he is talking about the quality of the education and what will be the way how we approach the students in the next 1-2 semesters to come without wasting their time, without losing their academic year. When he is giving these ideas, and we have taken up our EDP. Earlier, our EDP is mostly physically, industry executives are invited to our places, our campus, our guest house, our auditorium. But now this has given a new opportunity for all of us. We will definitely planning to do a series of this type of programs for benefit of all the executives, freshers, and the research scholars whose destination likely to be in the industry. So with these few words, I formally invite our Vice Chancellor to formally inaugurate this program. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Good.
I request our Vice Chancellor to deliver presidential address and inaugurate this program. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Very good morning to everybody. The head of the department, Professor Charumati and Professor Chandrasekhar Rao, the Dean of School, for putting very kind words about me. Let me straight away compliment the department for taking a lead in this direction of data analytics, because the kind of time we are passing through at the moment is a very depressing one. And under the present situation, when we are having this unfortunate pandemic, which has marred the spirit of everybody, we could have taken two views on this, two directions of there, or two sides of there of this. One, that we could have sat in our houses feeling depressed, doing nothing, and wondering and praying what to do, where to go. The other side is that we could have made best use of this in reading literature, in writing about this situation, how best to come out of it. And those of you who have been reading newspapers of late, there have been umpteen number of articles on what is going to be the course of education of this pandemic, what way the industry is going to shape up, what is going to be the fate of our labor problem, how economy is going to be handled. So if anybody who has read these, who has been reading these articles, will get a lot of new ideas. So one is that you can read and develop your own thinking on how best to come out of this pandemic. The second part is that what is the best course that can be chalked out for our universities and for our departments. So there, I must compliment the department that they have taken a lead and have organized a course, the CDP, on data analytics. In my opinion, you know, data analytics is a very important science. I have been always highlighting in all the chances that I get to talk about this, that wherever a data has been kept properly and analyzed in a very proper manner with the help of all tools that you use, the country has done well. Let me put it this way. And a country which is not bothered about it probably will never be able to take a right course towards the education, economy, infrastructure development, and whatever you may mention. Therefore, this is a good lead that the department has taken. It will kindle a right kind of spark in the minds of our young research scholars who will be attending this. And of course, it will give all the executives who are participating a direction that what is the best that can be done under the present scenario of this pandemic through which we are all passing. I am very sure, I'm repeating, that with the kind of diligence which is shown by our scientists, we will very soon get over this pandemic. There is no doubt about it. And the way we have faced this as compared to many countries, and if you analyze your person of data analytics, this workshop is all devoted to this. I will urge all of you to look at this, the kind of data I am projecting. I said we have done very well as compared to the other countries in handling this COVID-19. When you analyze this, you will find that the death rate in India is very low as compared to many other countries. And is it that the whole population is very highly educated, disciplined, or less populated, or we have more cleaner areas? It is not so. We are a very highly populated country, very heavily concentrated in cities, and the other habits of maintaining the right kind of discipline also not to that extent. But then still, despite all these limitations, we have kept the death rate very low. As compared to what we have managed, you look at the countries like United States, which is heading the list, unfortunately. Then look at Italy, look at Spain, look at other countries where the death rate has been enormously high. When we compare these countries with our country, the health system and the management, the cleaning, the general discipline, the density of population, it is far lesser and far better as compared to what we have in our country. And there the death rate has been extremely high. Now, what is the thinking that can go into this? This is a subject matter for all of you to analyze, but I'll give you certain hints. Of course, There is no proof of what I'm saying, but then I am leaving it as an exercise for all these experts who are going to be participating in this 5 days workshop. And you'll definitely, I'm reiterating, you'll definitely get a direction to whatever I'm saying. If you remember, and if I take your memory to good old days, way back to 1961, when in our country we started a program called BCG will be given to everybody, that injection, that vaccine, for controlling few of the diseases, typhoid in particular. There was a criticism all over that this is not required, why India is going in for this. But then with the kind of advice, the kind of decisions, the kind of thinking, we stuck to this. We said, no, we will go in for this. And we followed this regimen. And when we were doing, there were countries like Portugal followed, Costa Rica followed, Hungary followed, many Eastern Asian countries like Korea, Japan, they all followed this regimen. And if you now extend my argument to these countries, you will be surprised that the death rate in these places have been extremely low. Now, can we say that this BCG regimen has been responsible? I don't know. I said I don't have a proof, but I leave it as an exercise for you to analyze that what is the reason for that. Probably one of the reasons is that this developed an extra resistance in Indians, which has put them in good stead now in facing this COVID-19. And that is one of the reasons they are this hydrochloroquine, which they started again in a big way. All these things have led to an extra resistance development, which has put us in a better platform as compared to other countries. 1 minute more in this direction, if you pay attention to this. I said, Italy and Spain have had very high death rate. The adjoining country to that is Portugal, which followed what we were doing because they were controlling one of our states, Goa, and they had similar kind of systems. So they followed this regimen, and in Portugal, the death rate has been extremely low, though they are adjoining Italy and Spain. Italy and Spain had very high death rate. So you can think of, is it because of this vaccine regimen that they followed? I leave it as an exercise for you to collect the data and do this. Germany, on the other side, did not follow this in the true sense, but then they also had low death rate, and they are also adjoining Spain and Italy. You will say, what could be the reason? At that time, there was a country called East Germany. East Germany followed this BCG regimen, and now it's one country. And because of that, the death rate in Germany also has been very less. Some countries which I named, Australia is one of those. Wherever this protocol was followed, the death rate is lesser. That means we had our own way of analyzing, our own natural way, original way of thinking that if we follow certain things, probably certain protocols, probably we will be better placed, and which has proved by whatever I'm saying. It is an exercise for some of our research scholars who are into management department to take up this study and come to certain conclusions whether what we followed was a better one as compared to the other European countries or not. I leave it as an exercise. I already said there is no scientific proof, but I was reading many articles of late, and this is one of the things which emerged and came to my mind that I'll share it with you. I did share this with the statistics department when they organized the webinar. I am glad that you have picked up this topic, and of course, it's executive training development program that you're doing. This is the right thing because everybody can pick up some of these systems that our country had followed, and probably you can come to some better conclusions which will take us a long way in managing pandemics of this kind. Of course, with this, you can add on our Indian medicinal system, Yunani medicinal system, Ayurvedic medicinal system, and relate what I have said. You analyze, relate these medicinal systems with that. Probably, you will be getting very encouraging results. I am from a different discipline, but then you are the ones who can really, with your own managerial skills, give a better direction to our programs, and it'll help our government also in picking up the right threads. So I give my compliments to the department for organizing this at a time which I said is not a very encouraging time for everybody. People are feeling very let down, depressed, low. And when there is a webinar of this kind, I think it will lift their spirits. It will give them ideas. It will encourage them to read. It will encourage them to analyze. So this is a very right thing you have done. And we are in the threshold of starting a new academic session. We are discussing how best to go about it. This webinar will be a wonderful lead in that direction, that what best way we could open. And as I said, wherever statistics is better kept and analyzed, that country has certainly done better as compared to those where it has not been regulated in a proper manner. And this webinar will be a direction in that that line, that we need to analyze things better. We need to look at everything in a more deeper manner so that it could be useful to humanity as a whole and India in particular, our own country in particular. Let's pray that we get over this pandemic very soon. But I am sure that this five-day workshop will be a wonderful exercise in helping people in coming out of their shells to do better. I compliment the whole department and wish this webinar a grand success. Last word about the young researchers who are participating in this. I do not know. Professor Charumati will be able to tell me in terms of numbers, what is their number. But it should be an encouraging 30-40% out of the whole lot. If they are the ones, I will urge them that this is the right time to pick up certain problems related to research and analyze those. Thank you so very much, and God bless all of you.
Thank you, Professor. Out of 210, majority are PhD research scholars and faculty, and few executives have joined, sir. Thank you very much for sparing your valuable time, sir. I request Dr. Madan Moganji to propose word of thanks.
Most esteemed Vice Chancellor, most respected Dean, School of Management, and of course our head of the department, the coordinator, Professor Kasalingam sir, faculty members of DMS and other departments, scholars, and of course my dear participants. Well, this is our first online program, so I'm a little bit tensed actually, and I proved right. I got disconnected and I have to rush back to my department to join this inauguration. Let me start with thanking our Honorable Vice Chancellor. As HOD pointed out, he is very, very busy, we all know that. And amidst all this busy schedule, he has spared his precious time to be with us and inaugurate this program. Thank you very much, Vice Chancellor, sir. We are very happy that you are always with us for all our endeavors. And we promise that we will do better and better programs in the near future to come. Thank you very much, sir. And our Dean, sir, he was actually the base for this program, because he really kindled our interest to have this program done in such a short notice. We had the things in our mind, but when our Dean made a call, and it was really nice for us. So we started our journey, and we have reached this point. So we are extremely thankful to our Dean. And of course, our director, he gave us the permission which we needed in a short notice. So we are also thankful to our director studies for that. And our head of the department is always cooperative, and she's very energetic. And she wants more and more programs, and we will try our best to cater to her expectations. And thanks very much for her support and advice which she is offering us. And coordinator Dr. Kasalingam, we all know about him, his energy level and the way he thinks about things. So I should just appreciate him for all the energy he is showing and the commitment with which he is offering these programs, which he also showed it in his speech, how responsible we are to do these things. And special thanks to our research scholars, especially Mohan Sundaram and Lenin, for all their support which they are giving us. to organize and conduct the program in a cordial manner. Of course, importantly, we are very thankful to all our participants. Such overwhelming response, which of course when we started, we thought we will have response, but the response was really overwhelming. So we are really thankful to all the participants for all their support, which are giving us constantly during the past. They have been giving, and we are happy that such support is continuing for us even in this program. And we assure all of you that we will definitely cater to your expectations, and we come up with more and more such programs to cater to all the expectations of different communities, including the executives, corporates, research scholars, and the faculty members. So I'm thankful to all those who are instrumental in this program reaching to this level, and we are hopeful that the program will be successful, which we will come to know maybe after 5 days. Thank you very much to all of those who have joined us. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you so very much. Wonderful program.
Yeah, we now professor has declared the program open. Professor Kasi, you can start the session.